Is this the breakthrough? Mark Rogers TV, the voice of college football. The night after the win at Doe Campbell, Florida State 31, North Carolina, who was ranked fifth in the country, 28. Quite the scene in Tallahassee as the Seminoles pull off the upset against a 13 or 14 point spread, as Jason Parker joins us from NBC6. And of course, big game James Coleman from Fifth Quarter College Football. Boys, you have to be extremely excited about this win. I'm sure there's a take on it that could be critical. No points in the second half. Maybe North Carolina ran out of time. But the scoreboard reads what the scoreboard reads, and very few expected a Florida State win. Jason, we'll kick it to you in regards to vibe, atmosphere in the stadium. I could almost feel it on the TV screen in regards to, I'm sure it hasn't felt like that since 2016 or 17.
It was the loudest you've been in for a stadium that only had about 18,000 people. It sounded like it. It sounded like you had just the atmosphere. And yes, you hit the nail on the head. Being up 31-7 at the half will do that to you. And Joshua Cain does the interception for a touchdown. You know, Jordan Travis in the first half looking like an actual, the quarterback of the future, made it look like this team. I'm not ready to say they've turned the corner. We talked about it after the Notre Dame game, and you and Logan were saying, hey, the moral victory aspect. I'm not saying the corner has been turned, but I like the direction. And James and I, we said this before we signed on, a win is a win. You take the win. But, yeah, 18,000 people inside Doak, socially distant. I saw a lot of people wearing masks, so shout out to that. But, yeah, I will. A win is a win. That's my argument there. Win is a win.
James, I don't want to send your football knowledge in any one direction, so I'm going to leave it wide open. What's your take from this?
My take on it, again, so football knowledge out the window. This is pure fan and player, like, right now. So you take your wins however you can get them. And the positive side of it is you play dominant football from a feel and a look perspective for an entire quarter. If you can maintain that and really get that killer instinct, that's my biggest critique. Really, no matter what the numbers are, what anybody else says, it's really a killer mindset. You got the guy on the ropes. They're asking you to knock them out, and you're giving them every way to stay in it. So at just any point, like a field goal or something like that, like just if the opening drive of the second half could have been like the ending drive of the second half, oh, my God, I would have been ecstatic. I'd have been like, this is – Florida State, not even 2013 Florida State. This is like beyond that old dynasty years Florida State. And the reason why I say that is because you went in and you're going up against, whether we all believe they're a true number five or not, at that moment they were the fifth ranked team in the nation. And you punched them square in the face and you just beat the hell out of them. But they didn't. And it still leads to some criticisms. Of adjustments and players being able to maintain it. But I will say that was the most refreshing Florida State football that I've at least seen in the last 3 years.
When you walk on the practice field or are in the meeting room the next day on a Sunday after a huge win like that, and maybe in a situation where you didn't play on any teams that were as down as this team, but still, there's no more talent in the room. There's no more, nothing's really changed tangibly, but coming off a win like that, what does that possibly do for a team?
Well, I think for this team in particular, you start to get, like, they're struggling for buy-in. Like, I mean, I've said that the entire, like, the whole offseason and all this, you can lie to yourself, but, I know, I can pick up on tendencies and how people are feeling. So when you're telling me buy-in all offseason, you're trying to convince yourself more than you're trying to convince me. People don't have to talk about when they buy in. They just show it to you. But right now, that was a show. Now, are there things where they maybe lost trust? But the coaches now are starting to have a series of basically documents essentially to make a case for, if you do it the way I coach you to do it, you're going to have a level of success. And if they can get all 11 guys on defense, all 11 guys on offense doing this more, then they're going to be there. They can keep showing, like, hey, this could have been, we could have beat, like, because here's the elite lie right here. It's not that far fetched. We don't get penalties. Guys don't start freestyling in the second half. We beat North Carolina the way Georgia Tech lost to Clemson. Like, that's the, so you can start like having the guys buy in a little bit more, and they stop playing for themselves and they start playing for each other. So that's kind of the only way you build upon that and in practice. And then now your team leaders can start really calling cats out who are being selfish and be like, hey, we want more of these North Carolina type feelings than we want of the Georgia Tech feelings. And we definitely don't want any more of them on Miami butt whippings.
All right, James. So what worked in the first half that you really like?
First off, the special teams. That's one. The one bright spot of the entire season has been how well, not the special teams that aren't that everybody likes to brag about. So you can field goal kicker misses it, or a punter shanks it. You see that, but really, when people talk about special teams getting better, kickoff return, punt return, extra point, field goal block, punt block, things like that. So FSU blocking two punts, and getting that momentum early and like scoring right away. So like when you block a punt and then the first play coming out of it is basically Jordan Travis scoring or one of the first plays coming out of it. That's kind of that's what I really like. Also, really forcing North Carolina to defend all 11 players. That's something that's big in the RPO. And when you don't have an elite quarterback and you don't have elite passing, you have to be able to make them account every play. So Jordan Travis using his legs to get one-on-one matchups in secondary and seeing big plays downfield, like with Pokey Wilson, Keyshawn Helton, seeing them take shots, eliminating that theory that Jordan Travis doesn't have an arm, like that's what was really exciting. And I'm like, yo, this is the boom or bust or the big plays that Mike Norvell is known for. It's just sad that it seemingly went away. And somebody who I want to – I really – don't mind the Texas A&M transfer as a person. I'm sure he's a beautiful human being, but bring him in the third quarter. I want Webb and Toa Fali. Matter of fact, primarily Webb running the ball because he's got a better vision. He's able to do more things. He's the type of running back with a Jordan Travis that can really make things run.
Biggest takeaway for me, if you want to look at it, I'm going to break it up in the first half and the second half. First half, give the credit to Jordan Travis. Jordan Travis was the game leader. You know, the quarterback from West Palm Beach has lived up to the hype. You know, he did great against Jacksonville State. I never thought I'd say that. He kind of took a step against Notre Dame. I think he definitely solidified the leadership role in this game. You know, getting out there, being able to manufacture those touchdown drives, I'm going to give him credit for that. On the negative side of things, and sorry, I was having issues. I don't know exactly if James hit on this, but we said this. A lot of people were saying this, both me and my dad, my uncle were saying this the whole way. The two biggest issues for me I had in the second half were the fact that we couldn't tackle worth a damn. And the offensive line went from playing like a decent, somewhat decent offensive line to playing like hot garbage. That's what's going to kill this team in the games the rest of the way. Like, let's be honest, Clemson's going to kill us. Clemson's going to destroy us. But the win like this gives me a little bit of hope. But I worry that like Louisville is going to see this and go, okay.
Mark Rogers TV, the voice of college football, breaking down Florida State. We do it each and every week with these two and Logan Robinson from Noel Game Day. So you got James Coleman there in the middle from Fifth Quarter College Football, Jason Parker from NBC6. And they showed the goal line stand against Notre Dame that was meaningless to the score at the end of the game in South Bend. But that type of fight, I think Mike Norvell actually made the comment that kind of fight gave him inspiration. He thought it meant something. Can something like that, even if it's during garbage time, mean something?
I mean, I guess, like I said, that's the moral victory stuff. You never know what really gets guys going. But Notre Dame, the reason why I didn't take much from the Notre Dame game and even the positives and things like that is that Notre Dame did what they wanted to do when they wanted to do it. They could have ran the ball easily on us. They threw the ball very well. Like, there was no stopping them. They pulled up. If Florida State would have really shown fight offensively, Notre Dame would have really probably been – they would have just knocked us out again if they needed to. What I will say, though, is that maybe you could show a lot of film and show, like, where they were out of position, and especially in the run game. And this is why they made big gains. And maybe the coaches themselves said, like, listen, we got these guys playing on their heels entirely too much. We might as well be aggressive. The one thing about being aggressive and playing downhill is it forces somebody to make a decision. At least you know if you're going to die quick. Like they're gonna either throw the ball to open spot where you're trying to force them to, or they're gonna get sacked. But that whole sitting on your heels and having no idea what's about to happen to you, that can wear at your confidence. So we were more aggressive this game from the beginning to the end. It's just the second half, I believe they wore down. And that's where things like that fans don't really like to admit, like time of possession. I was going back and watching the condensed version of the game, and there was a stat that was like, I think about, so it was 7 minutes into the second quarter. And the time of possession was 17, almost 18 minutes for North Carolina, and 5 minutes for FSU. I don't care how good your defense is. Like, that's a long time for them to be on the field, and they're not scoring points. So what fans can go back to, I know we don't like to relive bad things, but go back to Boise State, and that's what you see. Boise State didn't score a lot of points in the first half, but they were moving the ball on our defense, and our offense was clicking. Second half, they stopped. They got better. They got stops on our offense. We didn't score a point in the second half, and our defense all of a sudden was just worn down because they were on the field entirely too long. And when you're doing stuff like that, North Carolina doesn't have to kind of get rid of their game plan. So whatever you got to do to figure out and pick and choose how you want to motivate your players, the biggest thing is it worked. And these guys were in position. They're in place. And I know a lot of people in the fan base are split. There are some prominent former alumni, Corey Simon, Marvin Jones, a lot of guys like that, who are pro Coach Fuller. There are guys like Antonio Cromartie who did a phenomenal breakdown of why the defense is inept or has been inept up to this point on Periscope, on Twitter. But all of that being said is players play and coaches coach. And if players don't, you're either coaching it or allowing it. If players don't consistently make the plays, that's how you get fired as a coach, no matter how good your scheme is. This game gave us a little bit of hope. Maybe these guys continue to develop and grow off of that.
Yeah, we certainly can't overblow it because at the same time, you got to string together performances. I won't even say wins, but performances that build on each other and clean up some of the issues that Jason was starting to allude to. And I'll let you take off on it since he's not here with offensive line, second half, missed tackle, second half.
I'll say this. We're still – what happens is – and I have to go back and probably look at the scheme or ask some questions, some tough questions, and possibly get some answers so I could know what they're supposed to do. But here's what we're trying to do on offense, not Florida State. I'm talking for North Carolina. When we're running, when the offense is running a counter or they're running a stretch concept or something where they want to get to. A running back wants to get to the edge. We want to seal the edge. And that's happening far too often with our defense. Now, if the coach is giving up the edge and we're trying to bring somebody, like have a force guy or something like that, like whether it be sometimes it's a safety or corner, you probably a better bet is you want to be able to make sure it's your outside linebacker. They're not filling fast enough. So you're seeing a defensive end get washed down and literally there's nobody coming and filling in that space. So basically wherever somebody leaves, somebody has to fill that spot. And we're not filling that spot and coming downhill quick enough. So elite running backs are seeing this hole, and they run hard. Like this, the running backs for North Carolina run extremely hard. Their feet don't stop moving when they make contact. So that's one of the things that's going on with that. Also, when a defensive end is supposed to set the edge on when you got a pull or a counter where you got a guy pulling and kicking out the end, he's got to squeeze down. And what that means is keep outside contained. But you got to pretty much bring the edge down so that guard or that puller doesn't kick you out or create a gap, a natural gap. And that happened better this game, but it still didn't happen well enough. And if you want to know a great example of us not doing it, go look at the second drive with Notre Dame popped a big run. So last week's game, you saw Janoris Robinson actually completely doesn't even spill, doesn't even hit the guard. Completely tries to run under it and misses the tackle and creates like this huge gap. So those are still things. Those are fundamental things. That's stuff that you shouldn't have to be coaching a kid right now at the Division I level. Like you should just be reminding them, but it seems like fundamentals have been so far removed from the program that you got to go back to the fundamentals. And unfortunately you can't have fun. You can't spell fundamentals without fun. So, but it ain't fun. It's boring football. So you got to keep doing that. Because secondly, the offensive line. I don't necessarily think the offensive line was as bad as the scheme was in the second half. And I think they had to take a step back because if you notice, and this is a body language thing, and I feel bad for him because if you're in pain during a game, that's real pain. Like, your adrenaline and your endorphins are so high that you don't feel – and I'm talking from a guy who played a whole half season with a broken hand and a torn labrum. So, like, I was in pain outside of it, but when I got in game mode, it was literally no pain. It was just, boom, you're just going, hitting. And you saw his non-throwing shoulder or his hand or basically his arm was basically numb. So – they tried to, but they didn't want to put in. You can't put Purdy in that situation. And they just really have no faith in James Blackman. So I think a lot of the calls were geared around being conservative and trying to get the hell out of there, which isn't a way to coach. Like, you don't coach conservative when you don't have Clemson or you don't have an Alabama type roster. You got to keep going. You got to cut the, you got to go for the jugular. You got to cut the head off. You got to stomp on them. You got to do that. You got to, if you're in a situation where you're fighting, there's only one outcome that you're concerned about when you're fighting, and that's ending it. That's, I don't know if anybody's ever been in a fight before, but if you've been in a fight, understand there is an outcome, there's an ending. So you have to end that. That's why, you know, and in football, the same way. You're not going for the disabled person, you're going to make sure that they won't get back up and attack you. So I think that's kind of where the offensive line kind of messed up. And there was time, and then just with Jordan Travis just didn't have the arm. Like, it just hurts. Like, so hopefully they figure out what's wrong with him. They can patch him up. Because, unfortunately, unless Chubba Purdy comes in and he's able to give you something similar, which I doubt it, this is the only guy that we have that can move this offense and make it effective.
8 for 19 for a 191, one touchdown, one pick. So obviously a ton of yardage for that many completions. But 8 for 19 is not what you're looking for. 36 runs, 19 throws. That's probably what you are looking for. And obviously with the lead by double digits most of the game, you're going to have that. To speak to your time of possession, 81 plays for North Carolina, 55 for Florida State. That's not typically a winning formula. But they got it done here, 31-28. All right, pressure on the quarterback. We saw more of it against Sam Howell and a really good North Carolina offensive line than we've seen in the past. Do you think that was more scheme or that was just players stepping up?
I think both. I think schematically, so again, it goes back to coaching and allowing it. I don't think Coach Fuller is a bad coach. And I think he's been getting roughed up, and rightfully so, because the product has been abysmal. Every defense, every play, every offensive play call is designed to work. It's all about if the players are going to execute it. So I think the one thing I think he did a better job of with blitzing is putting guys in positions to be man-to-man. Now, they figured it out in the second half. They circled what we call circle the duck, and they circled 27 and 9, and they realized that they could go and you know, they could exploit those guys. But in the beginning, they were getting there. I think we would be lying to ourselves if we did not say that the defensive line didn't have flashes where they showed what everybody talked about in the preseason. And that could have been going from making them two gap to making them be one gap to where you just got to go. You're just flowing. So typically you can do that when you got blitz and linebackers. So Marvin Wilson got some push a lot of times. The problem is they got the pressure and they got a bunch of almost theirs. We got to get rid of them almost theirs and actually get there. But I can also – Sam Howell is a very strong, sturdy quarterback that's athletic. So him moving around would help. But I do think – so Louisville has another guy that's like that, that's a very athletic quarterback that can make you pay with his legs for them almost there. It's kind of more sort of the De'Aaron King style. Not De'Aaron King, but more on that style than Sam Howell. But the scarier part is this, is if you do find a pocket quarterback that can do all of that, and they have better route combos, he just steps up in the pocket and just launches it and destroys you in the passing game. But I think what helped the defense too is the offense taking advantage in the first half. that completely knocked them off of their game plan, and they had to adjust. So that's what good teams do. The problem is you got to do that four quarters.
Check out the banner below. Florida State Seminoles Live Wednesday nights, 6 o'clock Eastern Time. 6 o'clock Eastern Time Wednesday nights with James Coleman, Fifth Quarter College Football. We got Jason Parker and Logan Robinson on the line as well. We will preview Louisville. We talk Florida State football, recruiting, everything going on surrounding Mike Norvell's program every week, and we'll preview the Louisville game then. James, it's always a pleasure. Appreciate you stopping by, breaking things down, and hopefully the winning continues.
Hopefully, man, it's stressful, but who knows? You just got to get a signature win, build from that, and then you get guys bought in. And because that you get guys bought in, and you get a couple guys in this class that can be difference makers, then that class of 2020, that class of 22 will be your difference class. But right now, Mike's got to continue to get them buy in. You got to climb and get 1% better every day, as he says.